Okay. Welcome everybody to the Assembly of Turkish American Association's Youth Committee History Talk and Trivia Night event in commemoration of the 19 Mayıs Youth and Sports Bayram. Today we will be hosting Consul General Engin Türesin and Professor Mehmet Erdem Yaya. We're going to start with a short opening remarks from the Consul General, discussing 19 Mayıs and its importance within youth, and a couple of other opening remarks regarding this holiday and how we can be involved as youth. So, Consul General, would you like to give a couple of minutes of opening remarks for the audience on 19 Mayıs?
Of course, it'll be my pleasure. I'll start in Turkish, and Is everything fine? Can you hear me well, by the way? Because
yes.
Okay. Ata Gençlik Komitesi'ne bu çevrim içi etkinliği hazırladıkları ve beni davet ettikleri için teşekkür ediyorum. 19 Mayıs Atatürk'ü Anma Gençlik ve Spor Bayramı münasebetiyle gençlerimizle ve gönlü genç olanlarla bir araya gelmekten büyük mutluluk duyuyorum. Konuşmamın geri kalanını İngilizce yapacağımı düşünerek İngilizce hazırlık yaptım. May 19 is a day of singular importance in Turkish history. It is the day when the Turkish people began, under the leadership of Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, the faithful journey which would lead, against all odds, to independence and self-determination. To put things into perspective, one must bear in mind that from 1908 to 1919, Turkish people had endured 11 uninterrupted years of wars and turmoil. World War I spanned less than half of this period. They would still have to persevere for another 4 years before peace would come to the land with the signing of the Treaty of Lausanne as a direct result of the victory of the War of National Liberation. As we commemorate Atatürk today, I will not focus on his military accomplishments. Atatürk believed the hardest battle was not the one fought in the trenches and on the fields. It was yet to be fought to drive the newly established country out of the ruin years of wars had visited upon the Ottoman Empire. This fight would be on many fronts, such as political, social, legal, education, industry and economy, to name a few. It would take longer, and it would determine the fate of generations to come. Atatürk and the founding fathers of the Republic knew well that their goal of creating a modern, developed, and prosperous country would take decades. The sustainability of this effort could only be ensured by instilling in the youth the ideals of people's sovereignty, a sense of ownership, belonging, and direction embodied in the Republic, an ideal to strive towards. In the post-World War era, while in Europe, ultra-nationalistic movements came to power, Atatürk defined Turkish identity neither on ethnicity nor in contrast to a perceived other, nor around animosities, but on its own merits. He rallied the people around the values of hard work, common good, independence, positive sciences, and culture. A nation whose mind, conscience and perception are free to make way for generations who would be masters of their own fate. This freedom that was bestowed to the Turkish youth is the key to the success of his vision. As hard as it is to summarize the significance of Atatürk in this brief speech, I think the measure of a great man or woman is that their ideas can continue to resonate long after they're gone. So much so that they are the sort of ideas that hold true regardless of the author or the audience. They are universal. When I think of Atatürk, one of the first phrases that comes into my head is, teachers, the Republic demands of you, generations whose minds are free, whose conscience is free, whose perception is free. Words to live by. Teşekkür ederim arkadaşlar. Bayramınız kutlu olsun.
Thank you so much, Consul General. Ve senin de bayramın kutlu olsun. I find it very, it's really great that Atatürk believed in the power of youth for coming generations, because youth shape the future. And so that's what the Ata Youth Committee strives to do. We want to empower Turkish American youth and bring them together. And that's one of the reasons why we're holding this webinar, is to bring them together in celebration of such an important, you know, holiday that Atatürk has bestowed to the future. So thank you so much for your opening remarks. If you don't have anything else, I guess, to add on to that, we really appreciated you joining us, and you are free to, I guess, log off. So yeah, thank you so much.
Well, it was my pleasure, Mehmet, definitely. As long as you show the sensitivity and awareness to continue to organize online events or any other events like this one, know that I'll do my best to be there. And I think it's very important that the initiative comes from your side and not from officials like me, because I think what matters the most is what you do as a second generation like yourself and your friends in this country, that keeps this awareness alive, the sense of history and belonging alive. And as much as you are successful Turkish American students that are living in this country that is your home, I think it's very important that we have bridges built between our countries, and we continue to stay in touch, and we really count on you.
Yep.
Thank you. I will be logging off in about 10 minutes. I have 10 more minutes before I have to leave. So I will continue listening a little longer. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So before we move on to the, I guess, history lecture portion of our webinar, I'd like to thank Ata and our sponsor, Nilüfer'sen Bilgin, as well as the rest of the organization for helping us make this event possible through the Zoom link and through, I guess, using their email list to send out news and awareness of our event that we're holding today. I also want to thank Professor Yaya, who will be presenting the next portion of our event. And without further ado, we'll go ahead and get started. Professor Yaya, do you have any opening remarks to make regarding the presentation on 19 Mayıs history that you have ahead?
I just want to thank you for giving me the opportunity to be part of this event. Herkesin 19 Mayıs Atatürk'ü anma gençlik ve spor bayramı kutlu olsun. Burada sizlerle olmaktan çok mutluyum. As an opening remarks, I have to say I'm not historian by any means. By education, I'm an economist. I teach economics, but Turkish history is a special interest of mine. And I'm very amazed with the Turkish independence war. I have tried to read as many books as I can related to the accomplishments of Mustafa Kemal Atatürk and his comrades. And I'm happy to share a couple of informations to the youth, why this is important day, why the Turkish youth in United States should care about the landing of Mustafa Kemal Atatürk to Samsun. I'll just give the context to the kids, to the youth, to individuals like you, and you will make the decision whether this is an important day to celebrate or not. So that's the purpose of my talk today.
Yep. I think we already know the answer to that question that you just posed, but it's great to have a sufficient background in exactly what led to this very special holiday. So with that, I'm going to give you the next 25 to 30 minutes. There's no rush to present your information. And then if there are any brief questions, I think we can take them. You have the opportunity to put questions in the chat if you have them, and they can be addressed near the end of the event if there is time before the Jeopardy begins. Professor Yaya, you can share your screen and begin your presentation.
Thank you, Mehmet. Again, the title of my talk is Mustafa Kemal Pasha's arrival on Samsun on May 19, 1919, and what's the significance, why we should care about his arrival. Now, I want to start with a general overview of Ottoman Empire pre-World War I. The empire was ruled by Abdülhamid II with an iron fist. The empire lost most of its land in European continents and Africa and was unable to match the military power of the other world powers. Ottoman agrarian economy was in the hands of Western powers with their long established economic privileges. We call them capitulations, capitulationlar in Turkish. And industrial revolution did not happen in Ottomans. Industrial production was non-existent. Most of the production was agriculture at that time. Ottoman army was defeated in Balkan Wars. Allied East European armies were at the footsteps of Istanbul. And a coup has replaced Abdulhamid II and restored the constitution in 1908. But a counter coup in 1909, March 31st incident, we call it, left the army divided and weak at the time of the World War I. Of course, there were partition plans for Ottoman Empire during the World War I. Before I talk about the fronts that Ottoman Empire had been during the World War I, want you to understand that the Western powers had already plans to divide and capture the remaining lands of Ottoman Empire, especially on the Middle East. If you look at those secret agreements that has been signed between the countries, you can see as early as 1915, Constantinople Agreement between France, Great Britain, who promised to give Istanbul and Dardanelles to Russian Empire with that agreement. There's also a Sykes-Picot Agreement of 1916. It's a secret agreement between Britain and France with the agreement of the Russia and Italy that defined the agreed control of areas, especially in the Arab Peninsula. According to this agreement, French obtained Hatay, Lebanon, Syria, and expressed desire for the parts of the southeastern Anatolia, while British controlled the Straits of Marmara, southern Israel and Palestine, as well as Jordan and southern Iraq. And finally, there is a Saint-Jean de Maurienne Agreement of 1917. It's a secret agreement again between France, Italy, and United Kingdom, where Italy was to receive all the southeastern Anatolia except Adana region. Now, these are the secret agreements that we have access during the course of the World War I, but there's also another Western ally, Greece, which is promised territorial gains if they entered the war. And the promised territories include the Thrace, Trakya in today's Turkey, islands of Gökçeada and Bozcaada, and parts of the Western Anatolia around the city of Izmir. Just for you to see that partition plans, you can see the Sykes-Picot line, the blue ones and the brownish-oranges line between the France and Great Britain. There's a line that goes through Iraq and Syria that splits the Ottoman land between those two countries. You can also see the Italian control and influence areas in Sykes-Picot in 1916 on the right-hand side. This is how it looked like during the course of the World War I. Now, Ottoman Empire came to the World War I as one of the central powers, allied with Germany, and entered the war by carrying a surprise attack using two German battleships on Russia in the Black Sea on October 29th, 1914. And Russia immediately responded by declaring war on November 5th, 1914. Now, although the empire sultan was in place at that time, the true executive power at that time were in the hands of the Committee of the Union and Progress. You might have heard about this Ittihat and Terakki Cemiyeti, and the three COP leaders, Talat Pasha, Enver Pasha, and Cemal Pasha. They were big supporters of Germany, and they believed Germany would win a world war, and they were siding with German forces. Now, Ottoman forces fought at Entente. We call the three large European forces, Great Britain, France, and Russia in Balkans, Gallipoli, East Anatolia and Middle East, Russia in the Battle of Sarıkamış, which is a failed campaign to capture Kars and Batum. And it also fought with the British in Basra, Palestine, and Gallipoli, whereas the French forces were facing the Turkish army in Gallipoli as well. Now, Ottoman Empire's general situation in post-World War I, you can think of 1918 and 1919, Mehmet VI, the last Sultan of Ottoman Empire, Vahdettin, we call frequently him, became the last Sultan of the Empire in 1918 after the death of Mehmet V. And Ottoman Empire's participation in the World War I ended with Armistice of Mudros, Mondros Ateşkes Anlaşması in October 1918. So Istanbul was occupied by British in November 1918, according to this armistice. Control of Dardanelles and Bosporus were given to the Allied forces. Ottoman Empire surrendered all garrisons, army forces outside of Anatolia. All the naval forces were demobilized and control of ports, railroads, all given to the Allied forces. And Allied forces were also given the right, important in here, to occupy any region of Ottoman Empire that threatens their security. So this armistice were actually the death sentence of Ottoman Empire at that time. And slightly after, a few months after the initial occupy forces of Britain and France, Izmir was occupied by the Greek forces on May 15, 1919. And the interesting part of this Izmir's occupation is Ottoman Empire had never fought against Greek forces during World War I. And Greek forces landed in Izmir just because they sided with the Allied forces in World War I without entering into any battle with Ottoman Empire. So you'll see that slight difference between those two neighboring countries makes a big difference in sparking the nationalism in Turkey or at Ottoman time at that time. So I just want to mention a couple of these protests and sparks of national resistance in the post-occupation of Izmir. There were a few protests organized in response to the occupation of Istanbul. That was a big shock for Ottoman Empire, of course. And in general, Armistice of Mudros, that this agreement was left with some protests among the public. But it was the occupation of Izmir that started the nationwide protest. Turkish press, despite the pressure from the occupying forces, played an important role in informing the public about the war crimes of occupying forces. And students, both high school and college students at that time, have been instrumental in organizing resistance to occupying forces, documenting the unfortunate incidents during the occupation of Ottoman regions. They held a meeting with more than 4,000 students and faculty, and they declared May 17, 1919 as the Day of Grief, Matemi Umumi at that time, which is a significant event in my opinion. Students getting organized and declaring a day of grief. Then there was a first organized protest for the public in Fatih, Istanbul, May 19, on the day that Mustafa Kemal arrived in Samsun, where Halide Edip, who was a very famous writer at that time, made a speech, and people carried banners saying Izmir will remain Turkish. I mean, you can get the flavor from here that even in that first organized protest, it wasn't the occupation of Istanbul, it wasn't the other places, it was Izmir that hurt the Turkish nation the most at that time. There were second and third protests in the Anatolian side of Istanbul, Üsküdar and Kadıköy, with more than 20,000. But the largest and well-documented protest was in Sultanahmet. We have pictures of this on May 23rd, 1919, with more than 200,000 people. So this is an incredible number of people coming to this Sultanahmet, which many of you might know that Topkapı Palace, where the Ottoman Sultan used to live, is at the footsteps of the Sultanahmet area. So Halide Edip was there again at the forefront and asking world for justice at that time. And here is two pictures from that protest in Sultanahmet. You can see the Sultanahmet Cami in the back. You can also see Halide Edip on the right making the speech. Now, on coming back to Mustafa Kemal's appointment, on April 30, 1919, Vahdettin appointed Mustafa Kemal as Inspector General of the Ninth Army. At that time, Mustafa Kemal was the victorious general of the Gallipoli. He was well-respected, and Vahdettin wanted someone loyal and respectable to send to Anatolia. But the question is, what was the purpose of this appointment? His appointment was in response to the occupying forces' request to demobilize the Ninth Army and examine the unrest in the northeastern cities. So it wasn't the purpose of go and gather forces against these occupation. It wasn't the independence war that was in his mind. It was the demobilization of an army and examining the unrest. So his orders were, I'll be honest with you, gave extraordinary extensive powers. If you want to read more about it, this is an amazing story about how politics makes an important changes in someone's life and someone's appointment at that time. Mustafa Kemal had close friends at the time, at the Ottoman palace and the Ottoman army, and they created this extraordinary powers for him. These are powers include the authority to issue orders throughout Anatolia, effectively becoming the general for all the remaining forces in Anatolia, and to command obedience from provincial governors. So these extensive powers vested in the appointment raise questions whether Vahdettin intentionally sent Mustafa Kemal to organize resistance in Anatolia. So that's always a question. Maybe Vahdettin had the intention sending Mustafa Kemal to organize this. But when we analyze the things that had happened right after his appointment, you will see that Mustafa Kemal had been recalled shortly after 2 months of his arrival in Istanbul. And he later dismissed from the Ottoman army, and imperial order was for his arrest was issued. So if Vahdettin had the intention to send him there, literature was clear about that, the intention was not there. Moving to the next page, here is Mustafa Kemal in Samsun and Amasya. Today we are celebrating his arrival in Samsun in Bandırma, the ship of Bandırma. And this marked as the unofficial start of the Turkish independence war. And we always repeat this, it's the unofficial start of the Turkish war. Why is it the unofficial start? Because you'll see the actions that he has taken after his arrival in Samsun led to a national resistance to the occupation. You'll realize that without any delay, he headed to inland for Amasya, where he announced the Amasya Circular, Amasya Genelgesi, on June 22nd, 1919. In this circular, he declared Turkish independence and integrity to be in danger and called for a national conference to be held in Sivas. So in this circular, he called for a national conference for everyone to come together to resist to the occupation. This circular also considered as the first written document putting the Turkish War of Independence in motion. You see two pictures of Mustafa Kemal at that time. Mustafa Kemal, before going to Sivas, he stopped by in Erzurum, and Erzurum Congress becomes more instrumental in Turkish independence war, because in this Erzurum Congress, which was held on July 23rd, 1919, they drafted a national pact. Many of us who are from Turkey have been raised with this notion of Misak-ı Milli, the national pact, which sets out the key decisions for the Turkish national self-determination. So they it includes the security of Constantinople, these people coming together there. They want a secure capital of Istanbul there, abolition of capitulations. We talk about that Ottoman economy suffering from these capitulations. And then the status of the regions within the front lines of the Ottoman Empire, inhabited by Turkish and Kurdish majorities, upon signing the armistice of Mudros. So they said these occupations where the Turkish and Kurdish people are in majority is not acceptable. So that's what the Misak-ı Milli is. Now, following Erzurum Congress, which was held only for 6 Eastern Anatolian provinces, a national Congress got together on September 4th to 11th. We call it Sivas Congress. And in this Sivas Congress, delegates from all Ottoman provinces united the various regional resistance organizations. We'll talk about these Defense of National Rights Associations, Milli Müdafaa Hukuk Cemiyetleri. They were instrumental on setting the seeds of that national resistance to occupation and independence. Now, after these two congresses, Ottoman Parliament was reopened by the Vahdettin. Last elections were held in December 1919, and newly elected 140 members of the Ottoman Parliament, composed of sweeping majority of these Müdafaa Hukuk Cemiyetleri, headed by Mustafa Kemal, opened the fourth and last term of the parliament. The previous three of those parliaments were closed by the orders of the Sultan in the past. So the parliament opened on January 12, 1920. Although Mustafa Kemal was the leader of this Müdafaa Hukuk Cemiyetleri, he decided to stay in Ankara. However, he took all the delegates individually and gave them some ideas of what this last parliament, Son Meclisi Mebusan, can do to further the purpose of independence. So the new session of the parliament convened on March 6th, 1920, and passed the Misak-ı Milli. Remember the Erzurum Congress, that they have this national pact. The same national pact has been passed at the Meclisi Mebusan. So this angered the allies, of course. The parliament members, including Rauf Orbay, were arrested and exiled to Malta for a year. And allied forces actually forced Vahdettin to dissolve the parliament on April 11th, 1920. There is a typo there, not 1920. So right after it convened in March 16, it just closed in April 11th, less than a month of survival for that Son Meclisi Mebusan. But they had done that, accepting the Misak-ı Milli at that Meclisi Mebusan was very critical in the direction of the nation. Of course, if we don't have a Meclisi Mebusan, what Atatürk has in his mind, which he was initially proposed, get a Grand National Assembly of Turkey in somewhere safe where allied forces don't have control over, which was in Ankara. So Mustafa Kemal sent a note to governors and force commanders asking them to conduct elections, to provide delegates to the Grand National Assembly. 100 members of the Ottoman parliament from the Meclisi Mebusan was able to escape from the allied roundup and joined that 190 deputies elected around the country by the national resistance groups. And in March 1920, Turkish revolutionaries announced the establishment of a new parliament in Ankara, known as the Grand National Assembly. So they had assumed the full governmental powers, and on April 23rd, they gathered for the first time, making Mustafa Kemal Atatürk its first speaker and the prime minister of that assembly. Hoping to undermine the national movement, Vahdettin passed a fatwa to qualify the Turkish revolutionaries as infidels, calling for the death of its leaders. So going back to later, Vahdettin had sent Atatürk to organize a resistance. You can see that that intention is not there with the later actions, such as this fatwa. Here are two pictures that I found on the internet. You can easily go and look at on the first day of the Grand National Assembly being opened in 1920. April 23rd. Of course, during this time, there is a Treaty of Serves, Sevr Anlaşması. It was signed in August 1920. Again, the Mudros, Armistice of Mudros, was the death call for the Ottoman Empire. And this is the last nails on the coffin. So it confirmed Anatolia would be partitioned between Greeks, French, British, Armenians, even Italians there. And Ottoman Empire were left in the middle of Anatolia. You'll see. Capital of Constantinople, Istanbul, as well as the Dardanelles would be under the International League of Nations, while the Ottoman Empire would remain as a rump state based on northern Anatolia, the region that you see with the yellow orange. Now, of course, Ottoman Empire signed the Serbs agreement, but the Grand National Assembly and Mustafa Kemal Atatürk had continued fighting in several fronts. In the southern front, Turkish forces fought against the French and the Battle of Maraş for 22 days on February 11, 1920. And French forces were forced to evacuate Maraş by the resistance and assault of the Turkish forces. Ankara Agreement in 1921 was signed in October 20th, ending the French-Turkish War. So that was securing the southern border was the first thing that Turkish resistance did. On the east, Kazım Karabekir was also the general in command, attacked Armenian forces controlling the area surrounding Kars, eventually capturing most of the territory in Caucasus with what we see in Turkey today. The Turkish military force was followed by Soviet Union's occupation and annexation of Armenia. If you want to read more about this, Russian Empire has collapsed. Bolsheviks came into power and they actually occupied and annexed Armenia at that time and many of the Caucasian nations at that time too. Treaty of Moscow and between Soviet Russia and Grand National Assembly and the related Treaty of Kars a few months later in 1921 confirmed most of the territorial gains by Kazım Karabekir and established the modern Turkish-Armenian border today. Of course, the time that we spend most is on the Western Front. The war, we say, started when Greek forces landed in Izmir on May 15, 1919. And Turks received the first victory when the Greeks encountered stiff resistance in the battles of First and Second Inönü battles by İsmet İnönü from January to March 1921. In June and July 1921, so a heavy fighting in the Battle of Kütahya-Eskişehir, which Greeks were victorious. Turkish army withdrew in good order to Sakarya River. And you can see that dashed line on the left where that last line of defense is right next to Ankara. And for 21 days, Turks and Greeks fought another pitched battle at Sakarya River in August and September of the same year, which ended with Greek withdrawal with the large red dot or a red line, which created this Greek defense line in Western Anatolia. Now, a year later, from 21 to 22, on August 26, 1922, in the Battle of Dumlupınar, the Turks routed the Greeks' positions and launched the great offensive, Büyük Taarruz, with an ultimate victory that they reached Izmir in 9 days, 400 kilometers on horseback riding. That's an amazing victory for Turkish nation at that time. Again, I'm talking about these very briefly. There is a long story behind each of those battles. And for those interested, there are a couple of TRT movies and documentaries on this. Cumhuriyet is one and Kurtuluş is another one. For those interested, you should take a look at those. These military fronts and independence war is being covered significantly there. So coming to the conclusion, I don't want to take too much time, but in order to understand the importance of Mustafa Kemal's arrival in Samsun, one should understand the Ottoman Empire's circumstances in post-World War I, as well as the consequences of his landing. His arrival indeed started an independence war for Turkish nation, but not only starting an independence war, that independence war ended in a miracle that turned the crumbling Ottoman Empire into a Republic of Turkey. There are many world readers that you can see that have traveled across their nations, but it's clear that none of these had resulted in such transformative outcome for a nation like Turkey. So you always think about what is so special about this landing? The answer is there. There is a miracle that ended after that 2-3 years of wars of independence, battles of independence, thousands of lives were lost. But at the end, Turkish nation was victorious and they established a new nation, a modern nation where people were able to elect their representatives. So if one day someone asks you, why you should celebrate a day that a general, Mustafa Kemal, arriving in a remote city, Samsun, in a remote nation. You can probably say, I celebrate this day because his arrival sparked a fire on a successful independence war. And maybe it would not be possible for me to be here if he had not reached there successfully. That's the lesson that I would like you to take away from this the short presentation.
Thank you, Yaya. Turks are, we're very strong people. And even after the Ottoman Empire was crumbling, it's great to see that we stood up and we took back our country under the leadership of Mustafa Kemal Atatürk. Otherwise, we could have went to the other alternative, which was that map that you had shown, which was definitely something that we would not have wanted. Do you have any final remarks regarding this history talk? Any final takeaways? If you had one sentence to tell the youth to summarize why this event was so important, and Onduk's Mayıs so important, what would you tell them?
I mean, I think I want to go back to that same sentence. I mean, this is an important moment because it changed the course of history for Turkish nation. That's why we are celebrating it. Atatürk has traveled different places as well. We don't celebrate every different travel of Atatürk, but this is a special moment that started that independence war. And I try to explain it in my brief presentation in here. That landing, that arrival of Samsun led to many more organized actions and resistance that led to the independence of Turkey. That's what I would like to let you know, and all the youth know, that this is a special day for Turkish nation.
Yep. Thank you so much. That is a great message. Consul General, do you have any remarks?
Thank you. I also wanted to thank Professor Mehmet Bey, İmam Mehmet Bey, for his excellent presentation. Brief, but very to the point. Information on this very important day. And I just want to take this opportunity to say thank you again, and also let you know that we're having a 19 Mayıs event at our consulate tomorrow, and I'll be happy to see Michigan, which is going to be represented at the event. Hopefully we're having the University of Chicago, Northwestern, Loyola, UIC, Wisconsin students and youth being represented at that event, if all goes well. And I just want to point out something over my shoulder here. We have a replica model of a Bandırma vessel. The marine vessel, which was recently gifted by one of our citizens here, a Turkish citizen who built it from scratch. So I'll be putting it on permanent showcasing it permanently at the consulate, hopefully once I find a nice window for it to protect it. It's very nice, and I hope you'll see it whenever you are here next time. So thank you.
Yep. And thank you for joining us, Consul General. I'll have to be there tomorrow as part of this to join to represent Michigan and the Youth Committee. So I'm really excited to be attending. Nilüfer, you had unmuted. Do you have anything before we move on to the trivia night?
Yeah. Well, I would like to thank Consul General and Türesin.
Nilüfer, you are muted, I think, still.
Thank you, Mehmet Yaya, putting the presentation in a very short notice. And as you said, Mehmet Efe, youth is our future. So as Atatürk also believed in that. So, and without knowing the history, we cannot understand today, and we cannot look forward. So I think these kind of webinars are important to teach or give at least a sense or a little brief information about the Turkish history to the young generations growing in the United States or elsewhere abroad, the Turkey. So thank you again, and wishing you happy May 19, Gençlik ve Spor Bayramımız kutlu olsun, and nice Gençlik ve Spor Bayramı kutlamalarımız olsun hep birlikte.
Evet, bayramınız kutlu olsun. And for all of the youth who are still here, or if you are a parent who knows of, you know, a student who is a high school or college student, invite them on the Zoom link, because we're about to have a trivia night on the knowledge that Professor Yaya just presented. The Jeopardy that we've prepared covers what he just presented. So it's great to kind of test your knowledge and spend some time with other Turkish American youth around the country and the world. And we're going to promote all of the attendees to panelists in a couple of minutes here. So if you have any kids or you have any people you who know you who are young who would like to be participating in this, invite them on. If you are already here, I see some of our members are already here. Keep waiting, as I believe Hakan Bey is going to promote everybody up to panelists. Thank you, Consul General, for giving your opening remarks. Thank you so much, Professor Yaya, for preparing that presentation and sharing that history talk. It was very useful for me and the rest of the youth who were here, and even adults as well. And thank you, Ata, for making this possible.
I'm taking my leave now, so goodbye, everybody, and hope to see you in the future.
Teşekkürler Engin Bey. Görüşmek üzere.
Teşekkürler.
Teşekkürler. So all the youth coming on now. If you're an adult, we're promoting everybody. You can just leave if you're an adult at this point. You can leave the event. Some of our members are already being promoted. I see Emir Olazan Onur. You guys can wait for everybody else to be brought up before we begin the Jeopardy night. You can also stay and watch if you want. That's also totally fine. If you don't want to participate or you're an adult, that's also fine. But we're going to begin probably in 5 minutes as when everybody's been promoted up.
Mehmet, do you see any in the audience that should be promoted to panelists?
I was on mute. There's some that I saw earlier. I'm not sure where they went. Hold on 1 second. I guess, is anybody here in the audience a youth who would like to participate in the trivia night? You can send it to me in the chat if you're able to. If you guys, because I know the people who are already in the Atta Youth Committee, are, I know who they are, but if there's anybody here in the audience who is, also would like to play, please, I guess, message me or unmute and let me know.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Would you like to participate?
I think I would rather watch this time around, and I'm not a youth, so.
Okay, that works.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, yep, thank you. Okay, we have Bora as well, who is joining from his dad's phone. So let me promote you. I don't know if this works. Bora, hello? Can you hear me?
Yes, I'll just join from my phone.
Great, awesome. We'll start at 6:50. Any last, I don't know if the people who are still attendees can message me, but if you can't, let me know, or just email Atta. We're trying our best to get everybody. Okay, I think we're ready to begin our trivia competition. So what I will do is we'll choose the teams first. So who here will be participating? Raise your hand or unmute. I know Onur, Ohuzan, Bora, you guys will all be participating, but is anybody else, would anybody else like to join? Okay, so then I will just make three teams then. one for each of you guys, and I will moderate the game. Can you guys see my screen? I think it's visible.
Yes, yes, we can see it.
Okay. Okay, I guess we can start the Jeopardy. So I will just call out your name and then you can choose one of the categories and the point values. Bora, do you want to go first and choose a category and a point value, and I'll ask you the question? Everybody will have 30 seconds to formulate their answer.
I have a quick question. So how does, like, are we doing like bounce backs? Like if someone gets it wrong, will the other people have a chance to try to answer it?
If you get it wrong, then you lose the amount of points. However, you don't have to answer each question. If you choose not to answer and somebody else steals, then they will get positive points if they're correct, and they will get negative points if they're wrong, but you will get zero regardless. So you're essentially saving yourself of a loss if somebody else wants to take or steal. If you want to steal, just verbally say the word steal. And if the person doesn't have an answer by the end of the 30 seconds, or they verbally give up the question to you, then you can steal it. Does that make sense?
Yeah, thank you.
Yep. Okay, I think we're ready. We'll start with Bora. Bora, which category do you want to pick?
Ottoman Empire for 500.
Okay, going bold. We'll start with Ottoman Empire for 500. So you have to name what it is, what the name is. A secret agreement between France, Italy, and the United Kingdom. Italy was to receive all southwestern Anatolia except the Adana region. Go.
Can I pass it?
Does anybody want to steal it? Ten seconds left to steal if any of you guys want to possibly get 500 points. Okay, time is up. The answer is, what is the Saint Jean de Maurienne Agreement of 1917? So unfortunately, that is negative points for you, Bora, but there's always a chance to bounce back. Next up is Onur. Onur, which one do you want to pick?
I'll go for Mustafa Kemal for 200.
Mustafa Kemal for 200. Mustafa Kemal's appointment was in response to occupying forces' request to demobilize the Ninth Army and the unrest in the northeastern cities of this peninsula. Which peninsula is it?
Anatolia.
Good job. 200 points.
Hey.
Ozan, it's your turn.
Last Ottoman Parliament, just 100.
Last Ottoman Parliament for 100. The Association for Defense of Rights for Anatolia and Rumelia was headed by this man. Go.
Mustafa Kemal Atatürk.
Mustafa Kemal. That was pretty easy.
Okay.
Bora, your turn.
Military fronts 100.
Military fronts for 100. The Turks and Greeks fought a pitched battle for this many days at the Sakarya River in August, September 1921. Which ended in Greek withdrawal. So how many days was it? And since this is, I guess, the question asking how many days, if you're within 5 days, plus or minus, I'll give you the points.
I don't know, like 15 days?
21. All right, that's close enough. I'll give you the points because you were close enough. Next up is Onur.
I'm going to go for Ottoman Empire 100.
100 Ottoman Empire. The Ottoman Empire came into this war as one of the central powers. Go.
What is World War One?
Yep. Simple question. Ozan, your turn.
Grand National Assembly of Turkey, 200.
Grand National Assembly of Turkey for 200. The new assembly gathered for the first time, making Mustafa Kemal its first speaker and prime minister on this day. Which day is it? You have 10 seconds left. You don't have to answer if somebody wants to steal. Time is up. Do you have an answer?
No.
Okay. And the correct answer, does anybody want to steal, I guess? I should ask that.
I want to steal.
Oh, okay. And what do you want to say? What's your answer?
I think April 30th. Do I have to give a year?
Oh, fortunately, that's Yirmi Nisan, actually. That's the date. So actually, you saved Ozan, but unfortunately, you lose some points. So I guess you can thank each other. I think it's Bora, your turn.
Ottoman Empire 200.
Ottoman Empire for 200. This man became the last Sultan of the Empire in 1918 after the death of Mehmet V.
Do I have to give like his full name or something?
You can give his name or the nickname that they used for him.
Mehmed.
And okay, well, do you know what number was after his name, if you're going to give that response?
Probably the sixth.
Okay, so what's your answer?
Oh, Mehmed the sixth.
Yes, that's correct. And you even had the D at the end, which is actually how they spelled it. The name, the T was, that was later on. So good job. Onur, your turn.
I'm going to try Mustafa Kemal for 300.
Mustafa Kemal for 300. On this day, Vahdettin had appointed Mustafa Kemal as the Inspector General of the Ninth Army.
I think I'm going to guess May 15th.
And April 30th, unfortunately. Okay, we have a tie right now. Ozan, it's your turn.
Ottoman Empire 300.
Ottoman Empire for 300. France and Great Britain promised to give Istanbul and the Dardanelles to the Russian Empire. I'm not sure what the question is.
Yes, me too.
Hold on. Oh, it's naming what this agreement was. Okay, I'll let you choose a different one.
Yeah.
You can choose a different one.
The same 400. Ottoman Empire, okay. 400, yeah.
Okay. A secret agreement between Britain and France with the assent of Russia and Italy that define the agreed control areas, especially in the Arab Peninsula. So you're naming another agreement here.
Yeah. it was very hard, this thing. It was like psyche, something like that.
You can try your best to pronounce it. If you're close enough, I'll give you the points.
Psyche-pito?
Sykes-Picot Agreement of 1916. Yeah. Okay, so that's good. You got that. Bora, your turn.
Military fronts 200.
Military fronts for 200, attempting to break even. Turks routed the Greek positions and launched the Great Offensive with an ultimate victory on this date. Go.
Do I just like a, can I say the year or do I need more?
You have to give the month and the day and the year.
May 15, 1922.
August 26, 1922. So you got the year, that's good. But unfortunately it was later on in August. So Ulnur, your turn.
I'll try. Last Ottoman Parliament for 200.
Last Ottoman Parliament for 200. This Sultan was forced to dissolve the Ottoman Empire on April 11th, 1919. Go.
Wouldn't that have been Mehmet the Fifth?
Is that your final answer?
Yeah.
It was Vahdettin who was the Mehmet the Sixth. So you with me? I have
so much good luck with this.
I know. Sometimes it's difficult to differentiate. Ozan, your turn. You have a hefty lead at this point. So what do you want to do?
Mustafa Kemal, 100.
Mustafa Kemal for 100, playing it safe. Mustafa Kemal arrived at Samsun on this day.
19th May.
It's only asking for the day, not the date. So 19 May, 1919. I guess that's an easy way to remember it. So yeah, good job. Bora, your turn.
The last 100.
Grand National Assembly of Turkey for 100. Mustafa Kemal sent a note to the governors and force commanders asking them to conduct elections to provide delegates for a Grand National Assembly which would convene in this city. So what city is it? Go.
I'm going to guess Samsun.
Samsun, is that your final answer?
Yeah.
It's actually Ankara, which is the capital of Turkey, of modern day Turkey. So close. But you can break even with 500 if you try later. Ulnur, your turn.
I'm going to try Mustafa Kemal 500.
You're trying big. Mustafa Kemal for 500. Mustafa Kemal and the Erzurum Congress drafted this, which set out key decisions of Turkish national self-determination, including the security of Constantinople, the abolition of the Ottoman capitulations, and the status of the regions within the front lines of the Ottoman Empire inhabited by Turkish and Kurdish majorities. What is the name of this?
Oh, I need a second. Hold on.
Unfortunately, time is up. Does anybody want to steal?
Wait, can I not like give my, you didn't like give, let me say like my answer at the last second. Is that, can I just try?
Well, yeah, what is your answer?
I'm going to say Mili Miyuk Karada or something. That's.
I guess I don't know if that's what you meant to say.
No, that's wrong.
Oh, okay. Well, I heard this, so you were, I guess, kind of close, but Ozan, it's your turn.
Military fronts 300.
Military fronts for 300. On 11 February 1920, after 22 days of the Battle of Marash, the French occupation troops were forced to evacuate Marash or Maras by the resistance and assaults of the Turkish revolutionaries. The Ankara Agreement was signed on 20 October 1921, ending the Franco-Turkish War. Go.
Oh, I don't know.
Does anybody want to steal? You don't have to answer, but
I'm not even sure what it's asking.
I believe it's asking you to name an event. I think it's telling you to name what exactly happened on this day. But time is up. Does anybody want to? You can answer, Ozan, or somebody can steal. Anybody want to steal, or you want to?
Be honest, I don't have an answer. So,
okay, then the answer is, what is the Southern Front? Okay, well, you're still in the lead. Aura, your turn.
Mustafa come out 400.
Mustafa come out for 400. This circular declared Turkey's independence and integrity to be in danger and called for a national conference to be held in Sivas. It is also considered the first written document putting the Turkish War of Independence in motion. Go.
I don't got an answer. Can I like pass it?
Does anybody want to steal? You have 15 seconds to steal if you want to. Time is up. No stealing, anybody? Bora, do you want to give a guess? Do you have a guess for anything?
Sure. Okay. Is it like a treaty of some sort?
So I guess, what do you want to say? Treaty of what you want to put in?
Treaty of Turkey.
It's called the Amasya Circular. Oh man, this is a little bit harder. Okay, you guys are tied. Ozan, it's your turn.
Wait, isn't it my turn?
No, it's owner.
Sorry, I'll say owner. You guys' names sound a bit similar.
Yeah.
Grand National Assembly of Turkey 300.
Grand National Assembly of Turkey for 300. Some 100 members of this legislature were able to escape the Allied roundup and join 190 deputies elected around the country by the National Resistance Group. What is the name of the legislature?
Oh, Büyük. Hold on. Büyük. I got one part of it. Büyük Millet Meclisi.
Ottoman Parliament. Can you say what you just said again? I don't know if it's a Turkish translation of it. Can you say that one more time?
The Büyük Millet Meclisi. It was the one that formed after the Ottoman Parliament was dissolved.
I'm not sure if that's correct.
It's not.
Oh, it's not?
It's not. I got the order mixed up in my head.
Okay. Oh, okay. Yeah, there are a couple of those. Ozan.
Hello. Hey, Mehmet. Hi, this is Ebru. The Büyük Millet Meclisi is Grand National Assembly. So yeah, it's not the right response.
It would or would not be the right response?
It's not.
It's not? Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Ozan, your turn.
Mm. Last Ottoman Parliament, 300.
The last elections for the Ottoman Parliament were held on this date.
December 1990.
Repeat that one more time for me.
December 1919.
December of 1990?
19.
19. December, which, what's the day? Ouch.
I don't know exactly the day, just like the information what I gave, the month and the year.
Oh, I guess they only gave that then. Yeah, good job. That's correct. Yep, I guess that was only what was included in the presentation. Bora, your turn.
Military fronts 400.
Military fronts for 400. The Greco-Turkish War started when Greek forces landed in Izmir on 15 May 1919. Turks received their first victory when the Greeks encountered stiff resistance in the battles of First and Second Inonid Battles, January to March 1921. So I think you're naming, this is a bit confusing. I'll give you a different question. Do you guys understand what you have to do for this one?
No.
No.
Okay. Oh, it's asking for locations. Okay. Do you want to choose a different one?
I'll just go for the 500.
Okay. Oh. This must be something similar. Kazım Karabekir attacked Armenian forces controlling the area surrounding Kars. You're going to probably want to name this area. Eventually recapturing most of the territory in the Caucasus. The Turkish military victory was followed by the Soviet Union's occupation and annexation of Armenia. The Treaty of Moscow between Soviet Russia and the Grand National Assembly of Turkey and the related Treaty of Kars confirmed most of the territorial gains made by Karabekir and established the modern Turkish-Armenian border. What is the region?
So probably a front, I'm guessing.
Yeah, I think so. How would you want to name that?
The Eastern Front.
Nice. Good job.
Yeah.
Older, your turn.
Let's go big. Last Ottoman Parliament, 500.
500 points. When the new session of the parliament convened on this day, it passed the Misak-ı Milli National Pact with the Turkish National Movement, angering the allies. What is the day? You don't have to name the month or the year. I think it's just asking for the day. So just name the day. Actually, name the month and the day. You don't have to name the year.
Okay, that made it easier. Thanks, I guess.
Yeah.
I'm going to say April 30th, because that's the only thing that comes to mind.
March 16th. We're close, I guess. March, April are pretty close. Ozan, your turn.
Yeah, 400 last Ottoman Parliament.
100 MPs, including Ralph Orbe, were arrested and exiled to this country.
Malta.
Really good.
That was really surprising. Like Malta, I didn't expect that, so it stuck in my mind.
Malta's an island, so yeah, it's not
a yeah. We planned a trip there when I did an internship, so that's why it was a connection. So,
yeah, that's great. Bora, your turn.
Grand National Assembly of Turkey, 400.
Time to break even. Turkish revolutionaries announced the establishment of a new parliament in Ankara, known as this, on March 1920. Go.
Um, The the one that was like.
Okay, I understand what you're saying. The Grand National Assembly. I don't know, once again, if that is. No, actually, you're correct. I just looked up. Yeah. Grand National Assembly of Turkey. Türkiye Büyük Millet Meclisi. So you got 400 points. Good job. Wait. You just said the Turkish version, Bora.
Oh.
You look at this.
The Turkish. Wouldn't the Turkish version, the Turkish version is Büyük Millet Meclisi.
That's what he said. Right? Is that what you said, Bora?
I said millet. I just couldn't get the last part.
I guess he said his attention was the right thing with the Büyük Millet Meclisi, because Ebru abla said something about it too. So
yes, that's
difficult.
Yeah.
Okay, well, we have one final 500 pointer left for you, Onur.
Oh yeah, I'm gonna get
undermine the national movement. Vahdettin passed this to qualify the Turkish revolutionaries as infidels, calling up for the death of its leaders. Go.
I don't remember.
Can I steal?
Who wants to steal?
Me.
Okay.
Fatwa is something like fatwa. He, what I said, took a fatwa from the whatever it is, from the code.
Yep. Fatwa.
To making this. Wow. Yeah.
So we have finished the Jeopardy. The final score is Ozan is the winner with 1,500 points. Bora is second with 0 points. And Onur is third with negative 1,700 points.
Yes!
Regardless, yeah.
It was a nice job, guys. Really.
Yeah, regardless of where you placed, it was a great learning experience.
Really hard, to be honest. Really, really hard. Especially, like, you have to remember the numbers and the dates. And was, like, April, May, December, 1990, 1920,
it was really hard, if you couldn't tell from how well I did in the points.
Yeah. Good job to everybody, even to Bora. Bora's only in eighth grade, so he's still
nice.
He's still very young, and he's already learned quite a lot. So
good job.
Thank you.
So I believe we're at the end of the event. Nilüfer, do you have any final comments to make?
Well, congratulations to all three of you, at least showing the courage to attend. I agree that they were all very hard questions, and I blame on Ella. She prepared it. but I hope you at least learn a couple of things during the seminar and also during the questions that you struggled with. It's fun too. I'm glad you joined. Thank you guys. And thank you, Mehmet, for organizing this. Yeah. It was a great pleasure listening to you guys.
Thank you so much to everybody. And once again, we are accepting video submissions. We're still finalizing our video. But if you would like to submit a video of you playing a sport and then saying "19 Mayıs" in this kutlu or something along those lines, maybe stating a couple sentences on the importance of 19 Mayıs, you could send that over to me or our Instagram, and we'd be happy to put it in our video that we're preparing for tomorrow. That will be, I guess, highlighting a couple of our youth playing different sports while, you know, stating the significance of 19 Mayıs and celebrating it. So you can send that video over to me if you would like to, but if not, that's also okay. Thank you for attending the event. Thank you, Atuf, for making this possible. And have a great evening, everybody.
Quick question. Where will we be able to see the finalized video?
I believe I'm going to give it to Nilüfer Abla, and I think she's going to email it out or put it somewhere.
Yeah, we can post at the ATA YouTube channel once we download the video from Zoom recording. We can share in the WhatsApp groups.
I think he was referring to the, were you referring to the short video?
Okay, same thing. Once it is done with editing, and so we can share at the YouTube channel.
Yep.
Thank you again, Mehmet. And I asked you this say on my WhatsApp message, so you don't have to reply or read even the message, just for your information.
Oh, okay. Yeah. We're Iran is editing the video. She can handle all of that. So and send it over.
Yeah, I was hoping it would be ready for tonight's event, but I guess last minute changes.
Okay. Well, thank you all. And have a great evening. If you have any other questions, let me know. Message me, message our Instagram account.